Welcome to some new r/malicious compliance stories, where people comply to the letter, but not the spirit of a request. I hope you had a great day. The first story is called The Resignation Letter. Ever since my sister and I went to kindergarten, my mom worked at a nursing home. She was a registered nurse. After 20 years, both mom and dad moved, downsizing. But my mom is a real hard worker and wasn't ready to quit yet. So she got a job at a nursing home, getting less than her credentials and experience warranted, but she wanted to help people. They were often short-staffed, so many times she'd be helping someone transition a patient from bed to bed before finishing up the medicine paperwork, etc. So she was averaging about 45 hours a week. Management told her that she needed to keep to 40. She kept on doing her work the way she was before. They called her in. She said, "Do you want me to drop the patient and dash out of the door and not finish the legally required medicine records?" She offered to be switched to salary, and she'd have no problem getting paid the same as a 40-hour work week, even if she ended up doing 50 hours. They said no, the position was hourly, and that was that. Then she got in trouble a third time. She was told that she just needed to manage her time better, to never get involved with moving patients in the last hour of her shift, not help anyone who needed it while working the medical logs until done. That was the how to deal with this problem they put on her official written reprimand number 1. Mom was very upset by this. It just wasn't practical due to staffing issues. She was being called in to do things because other people were adhering to the 40-hour only rule. There was a case of, this patient needs 3 people to move safely, but there were only my mom and 2 other people on the night shifts. This was because 2 could, in theory, handle everything, but in reality only about 75%. So it was, move the patient now and then go home, or patient stays in bed for 8 more hours. And then there were the sheer number of things undone that meant that the night crew wouldn't get them done, etc. So they called my mom in for official written reprimand number 2. My mom said, "Don't bother," and pulled out a letter of resignation. She told them that morally she could not do the actions they were asking her, as she felt responsible for her patients. They could fire her, or they could offer her a salary, or they could just let it continue. But if they were going to expect her to abandon her patients to substandard care, she was going to resign. More than happy to give them 2 weeks, more than happy to quit today. The HR person was quite taken aback and hurried to make some phone calls. The leadership came back in and took away the written reprimand and said it wouldn't be a problem if she was a bit over 40 every week. My mom said, "Okay, but just so you know, in case you change your mind, I'll be keeping this resignation letter in my purse." The next story is called Laminated. At the time, I worked in the copy center of a popular office supply store. One evening, a 30-something man came in with his Super Bowl tickets and wanted them laminated to preserve them. It's important to note that lamination does not preserve items long term. It yellows and cannot be removed from the item, makes it difficult to determine if the item is fake, and eventually falls apart and peels. Secondly, and more importantly, lamination uses heat, so it turns heat-printed items, like Super Bowl tickets, solid black, which eventually fades completely. It would ruin the tickets in 20 seconds. So I told him this and refused. He insisted. I refused, which was 100% allowed when it came to the lamination machine, as it destroys the customer's original media. He called me some names, so I continued to refuse. He called for a manager. The manager had exactly 0 patience for any shenanigans at all. He told the customer no. The customer carried on with the tantrum. I typed up a basic release form as I knew what was coming. It stated that lamination would destroy the tickets, had everything about the tickets, and was relatively ironclad coming from someone who makes minimum wage. The manager finally said fine, we would laminate them. I handed him the release and he insisted that the customer sign it. He told me to laminate the tickets, and I refused again, knowing that I could still be disciplined for ruining the originals. I always had the backing of management to refuse to ruin things. So the manager laminated the tickets. The tickets turned black. The customer lost his mind. The manager retreated to the locked office. The cops showed up and hauled off the customer. Corporate was not involved somehow, probably because of the cops. The customer claimed the tickets were worth over $1,000 each, but not anymore. The third story is called Delete Your Work. I used to work as an office manager, but had to do a lot of extra tasks as well. One of those was managing inventory for the finance team. I compiled and organized everything, and they used it for insurance and other purposes. When I got hired on, I had to make the tracking method for all of the company's tech and assets from scratch. I was a little curious how it had been done in years past, so I finally got my boss, who was not new to the company but relatively new to this position, to explain. He and a few co-workers took me out to a bar, had a few, and told me the story of Greg's blaze of glory. The person who used to have my position, we'll call him Greg, came from a data analyst background and was a huge overachiever. His boss, we'll call her Sharon, was a horrible manager. Awful with tech, notorious for pushing people too hard, because people only do good work when their job is on the line. And she got a promotion every few years by taking credit for her tortured underlings' work. She was head of a few departments, but technically the head of building services as well, which really just meant Greg. One year, Greg decides to go overboard on the inventory. The company was working with aging laptops that were largely purchased ad hoc rather than large batches, so there was a mix of models and years. No one except VIPs got new laptops, so he decided that he would make finance get new laptops for everyone. When doing the inventory, he added a bunch of helpful but previously unnecessary information. Things like warranty expiration dates, almost all were expired, the average lifespan for models based on reviews, etc. He sent this to finance as part of the standard package, hoping they would see all of the coming catastrophes of all cheap laptops dying. They loved the info and set up a meeting between finance, IT, some of the VPs and building services to talk about this. The assumption was that IT wouldn't want to buy new ones, so they asked this department to pitch how bad the current state was. This is when Sharon's awfulness kicked in. She saw this as a big project that she could lead in order to make herself look better with the entire staff, giving her an edge in competition for a then empty VP position. She told Greg to make the presentation, but added a ton of things to make it harder. Draft staff surveys to gauge interest in different brands. Present in-depth info on the best new alternative laptops. Start doing pricing estimates. Contact local stores to see if they would buy old ones, etc. A ton of extra work, and the meeting was in a week. The problem though was what she told Greg next. Sharon told him to remove any evidence of his work because she was going to present and take credit for it all. Then she implied that she would try to get him a promotion once she was promoted. He was furious, so then it became, if this looks like you did it, I will fire you. So Greg did everything she asked, working hard to make this thing perfect. He made a great presentation, made some extra documents for more in-depth data on the current inventory and possible alternatives. He even looked up graphic design concepts to polish off the whole thing. She skimmed it to make sure it looked good, but never actually read it. Finally, the day comes. Greg hands her a flash drive with the presentation without a word. Sharon walks into a room with all of the senior level executives, confident and ready to wow them. She plugs in her laptop, opens the file and discovers that it isn't her presentation. In fact, it's just 100 plain white slides with a poem on them. A poem about a cruel ruler in ancient Egypt who built a name for themselves by creating great works through the suffering and labor of others. A poem about how all of those works have since been obliterated by time, and that all that remained of the ruler's legacy was their narcissism and their cruelty. Every supporting document was the same thing, just a poem in Excel, Word, etc. Greg deleted everything he had worked on for this project, in every form of storage. He also resigned as the presentation was set to begin by emailing Sharon, HR and all of the VPs. Sharon tried to say she was hacked, but apparently a few people in the meeting came to his defense. He had consulted with them on parts and told them about how she had said to remove every evidence of his work. She was fired on the spot. Greg went out a legend, a few employees still buying him free drinks whenever they run into him. My manager got moved to her position and I was hired a few months later. The last story is called Schedule Compliance. This occurred in a country that has both an awesome set of labor standards and a common practice of companies ignoring them, especially in my field. I was starting a new job. The basic contract had no serious red flags. After signing, the owner asked if I would be willing to work late 1 or 2 days to go home early 1 or 2 other days. I told her it was fine, as long as it was an even trade. Later she said I should be at work 30 minutes early because work starts at 9 a.m. sharp. I met with the manager once before the start date and she said the same thing about coming early. I decided to see how the rest of the work and schedule went before making us think about it. If the hours were lax and they let us go home after racking up, no big deal. I started my first day and the schedule was a train wreck. I'm scheduled to work late 3 days and go home early 1 day. Hours work out to 40, but still not what I verbally agreed to. Breaks are 15 to 30 minutes throughout the day, and our labor standards state that for 40 hours they should be a minimum of a 1-hour block. Besides the small breaks, work was straight through 9 to 6. Breaks are unpaid and don't count against the 40 in this country, but are still mandatory. Even after you wrap up your duties, you are expected to stay. Whenever I just mentioned needing to talk about it, the manager just said, "It's okay, or we can change it now," and refused to even listen. I kept meticulous records of my time and I comped the labor standards. More than 8 hours of work per day is overtime. More than 40 hours of work per week is overtime. Any break that doesn't meet the minimum requirement is considered work, i.e. overtime. The owner asked me for a meeting when I'm on my way out the door. More overtime. After the first month, I handed the owner my invoice for overtime payment. She was livid. Coming in 30 minutes early was a suggestion. No, I was told to do it by two supervisors. The breaks add up to 1 hour each day. That doesn't matter, they should be a solid hour, not piecemeal. The meeting was just us talking. You told me you needed to talk to me. You didn't ask. You agreed to work late some days. Yes, for an even trade. This schedule isn't even. Why didn't you talk to us? I tried, and the manager refused. The owner took the invoice and said she'd think about it. Her husband was a lawyer, so I'm sure she looked for a race to fight it. In the end, I was paid. My schedule was magically reworked to meet the requirements, and they begged me to not tell the other workers. I didn't directly tell the co-workers. But I did drop big hints about the labor standards when they asked about my schedule versus theirs. Sadly, they never pushed the issue. During the year I was there, I saw a huge employee turnover. They were simply overworked. One poor worker cried at least once a week. Only two workers that were there when I started remained when I left. The turnover led to client retention issues, which led to downsizing for the next cycle. And with that, we end today's video. Let me know what you think about the stories. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate the stories and today's video? I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please don't forget to subscribe and hit the like button. And I hope you have a great day. Stay safe. Bye bye.